Well, we've been in Australia 50 years this year. We set sail from Southampton 16th of October 1972. So we're exactly 50 years. And we've been married 52.
What it was, we got married in 1970, and I always fancied doing something different. We've never been out of England. We thought it'd be nice to emigrate, really. So I contacted Australia House, Canada, New Zealand, South Africa, got all these brochures, and in the end I said, let's go to Australia. So she said, I'll go to Australia if there's somebody to go with or somebody to go to. Well, I thought, well, I don't know anybody in Australia. I don't even know really where Australia was, but other than it's somewhere down the bottom of the planet. And so I thought, oh, well, I'll leave it at that. About 2 weeks later, my cousin Barbara, who's Pam's best friend from school, came with her fiancé, and he said, well, when we get married, we're thinking of emigrating to Australia. Well, I thought, who's better than your wife's best friend?
And yeah.
Now with somebody else.
So, therefore, I had to come. I didn't really want to come, but I thought, well, give it a go. And I said to Jeff, look, we were 10-pound poms. It was a big adventure. And
tell us about 10-pound poms for people who don't know.
It was a drive to get, well, to get Europeans to Australia, UK migrants. And you just had to pay £10 for your passage, but you had to stay 2 years. And I said, okay, well, if I want to go back at the end of the 2 years, we go back. And actually, that's what we did. We did go back after 2 years.
We did, because the £10 poms are also for skilled migrants.
Yes.
Because I was in the motor trade at that time.
It was difficult because, to tell you the truth, 50 years ago, Australia was further than it is now. It was more cut off. I mean, now we've got the internet, we can talk to people in England. Then you were just phoning each other, and you had to go to the post office to phone. You had to book the call.
It was, and the cost of it was, my salary at the beginning was $80 a week, but it was $2 a minute
to
phone the UK.
So.
And when you phoned them up, you had to phone our parents' next door neighbours, because our parents didn't have a phone, so that cost us $10.
So 40 minutes of conversation
of not and
yeah.
And also the time lapse, you know, there was you said it, and they were talking on top of you all the time, so that it wasn't really good, was it?
They always wanted to know what the weather was like.
Yes.
And you think, God, it's costing us a fortune just to tell you the weather.
So it was a pretty big deal to leave your town, because
it was such a big deal that our parents came down to London, and it was the first time our parents had been to London. They came down to London to see us on the boat train, because there was a special train went from Waterloo to Southampton to actually join up with the boat. And it was the first time they'd ever been to London, which really you can't imagine now, can you?
It was exciting for me, but obviously upset for my parents, because I was the only child of my parents. And the trains in those days, you had a carriage and you could lower the window down under the door. And we were saying, we had to get on the train, which we did. Then the whistle blew and it started shunting out. And my mother's favourite song was the Danny Boy. And I still don't know to this day why I did it, but I was just singing to my mother, oh, Danny Boy.
The pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses falling. It's you, must go, and I must buy.
Oh, and she's got tears coming down And they went back up to Wakefield, and all around Wakefield there's working men's clubs. I suppose it's like an RSL type situation. And on a Friday and Saturday night, there's always a singer on at the club or a group and things. And it was the days where you could always guarantee they'll start singing Danny Boy. And every time they did, Mum, oh,
my that was baby. Terrible, wasn't it? Absolutely awful. Yeah. Oh.
So you hop on this boat, you've only been married 2 years.
Mm.
How did you meet?
We met in the pictures. 52 years ago, when you went to the movies, well, they weren't called movies, we went to the pictures, didn't we?
Yeah.
You got two movies, you got the news, and you got a cartoon. So in the middle of all that, you had little intervals, and the ice cream lady would come out. So I'd gone with Barbara, my friend from school, and we'd got ice creams, and then Barbara had gone off to the ladies, and I was sitting with her ice cream. And he came and sat at the side of me. And I thought, oh, this is a bit weird. And he said, can I have a lick of your ice cream? Well, I nearly hit him across the face. I said, we went out for a long time. We were only very young then, weren't we?
Oh, yeah, I was only about 16 or so, 17.
Yes, and I was about 15. First thing that hit me about Australia was the light. It was really light. The colours of people's clothing, because we were used to wearing browns and, you know, greys and black and all the rest. And also the colourful shrubs, you know, and the trees, and it was just the light. It was, you know, it was blinding really. It was lovely, and you could feel the breeze between your feet, because we never took our socks off, stockings off. So, but once you put your sandals on, you could feel the breeze in your toes, and I thought, oh, this is lovely.
We got off in Sydney. We went to.
The Endeavour Hostel.
Gospel. Yeah, this Botany Bay Endeavour Hostel. It was fairly new in those days. And we got took there for the day. And at evening time, we got then bused to, I don't know which railway station it was, but a railway station, to be taken up to Brisbane. And these lovely shiny coaches came up here.
Oh, the sleepers, yes, yeah, I remember that.
Gee, Australia's looking after us. And they went by and they ended up with these sit up and beg seats. So for about 10 hours, we just sat there. Oh dear.
Yeah.
But then for breakfast, they had steak.
Yes, we couldn't believe it, could we?
Steak, oh, what's this place we're coming to? Steak.
Yeah. Steak and this massive tomato, half of a massive tomato,
yeah.
Which was like a football, wasn't it? Because we were used to the little English tomatoes. This massive tomato.
Mm.
I remember that, yeah.
Yeah. So we arrived in South Brisbane, and we saw all these timber built houses on stilts, and you know, I've never seen these before.
We thought, well, we've got to get a car, so we walked across Story Bridge and went to the car yard, didn't we, Eagers?
Oh, yeah.
And while we were there, we said we'd just arrived, and they said, oh, what do you do? And Jeff says, well, I'm a motor mechanic. And he said, do you want a job? So that morning we bought a car, we got a job, and the afternoon we got a flat, didn't we?
Yeah, yeah,
so that all happened in a day.
Oh.
Yeah, it was brilliant.
Did you decide, no, 2 years we're done?
Yeah, it was at the back of my mind that we would always do
good
that.
Times. Like in those days, a good old English pub, nothing like an old English pub with an English beer, and it's not hot either, I don't want to keep saying it, but we kept thinking of the good times. And we thought, well, Melanie, our daughter, was the first grandchild to both parents. So we went back and...
With the intention to start.
Yes.
Stay, yeah, but
and Jeff got a good job. Yeah. We bought a house. Everything was fine. We couldn't settle. We changed our outlook on life. We didn't want to go back into the routine of what happened in England, did we?
That's
really?
That's right. That's right. So... But this time it cost us money.
This time we had to pay our own way then.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of a storm, there's a golden sky and the sweet silver song of a lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain.
I started up back in the motor trade again, but I was getting to a point that I hated it. So a neighbour of mine was in the Queensland Police. So I went and had a chat with him to see what it was all about, and there's such a variety of work, I thought, I'll give it a go, and I got in. My first training station was at Wynnum, and a lovely place beside the Moreton Bay, and it's the first time I'd ever seen multiple dead bodies, the people who were passing away during the night, and that sorted that out. Traffic accidents, people who are insane, I suppose, in a way.
Yeah.
So that was all new. Well, it's new to everybody, I suppose, but that took a while. So my second station, training station, was in the city, and it was quite funny, really. You had these big manuals that would give you, they don't do them nowadays, but and part of it, on when you were on city beat, you're supposed to walk at a certain speed. Well, I can't walk slow. So when we were on our city beat, I used to walk around twice as fast. So if anybody was going to do anything, they'd have to be quick. And I was thinking, well, if I'm going in for promotion, if I go into plain clothes, I can have the choice of either a uniform or plain clothes for promotion. So I went into juvenile aid, you know, juvenile crime, and I was at Camp Hill for a couple of years. And part of that time then, you had to go into child abuse. And so I was, and usually it was 12 to 18 months, then you went back to your station where you came from. Well, at that time, to do my stint in child abuse, it was in the middle of the Fitzgerald inquiry, and they changed a lot of things, and they made child abuse part of an area called Crime Operations Branch, where they had, it was investigating major and organised crime. So I was kept on because I was one of the senior officers in child abuse, and I was there for about 4 years, and I had to.
And it almost killed him.
Yeah, I had to go see a psychiatrist. I suffered from depression for a short while, and then I moved from there into auto theft, which again, it wasn't just an ordinary car being stolen; it was organised crime. But because of my motor background, it found it a bit easier. And then went property crime, and then ended up in education and training.
And were you working during the time when he was in the police force?
Yes, I used to work for the Uniting Church. Mm. And I started off doing accounts because I was in banking, and ended up with payroll manager. So we had about 1,200 staff, so it was quite a stressful job. And that was what led us to go to open the bed and breakfast. It was quite stressful being doing payroll, and it was quite, Jeff had had trouble in the place with, you know, stress. So we thought, no, we'll do something totally different. And so I wanted to go straight away as soon as I saw the photographs of Tasmania. And we did, and we made a good go of it. We opened the bed and breakfast. It had been run half-heartedly as a bed and breakfast, and so we put a lot of effort into it. We were there for 14 years. We ran it in a way that we welcomed everyone, and we offered afternoon tea, and we also did evening meals. So we got to know our guests, and within a very short time, we were getting a lot of repeat business, which was really good. But also, we found too that people were coming through, and because they didn't know us, they were telling us all the problems. And we'd sit there in an afternoon, and they'd be telling us all about themselves, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
And I realised then, people just want you to sit and listen. So actually, when we came up here to Batemans Bay after we retired, we worked, we volunteered at St. Vincent de Paul in the conference there, and people came through there asking for assistance. But many times, they're just wanting to talk and tell you their problems. So we seemed to have that effect, didn't we, on people?
Yeah. That's an old photo of Wakefield, Yorkshire, where we come from. Okay, this is the boat that we came to Australia on, the Alinus, and we left on the, what did it say, 16th of October 1972. This is Jeff and myself on the Alinus, very glamorous. This is an old photo of Jeff and myself with the two girls before we came back to Australia. The second time, and this is the bed and breakfast that we had in Tasmania. And if we open it up,
oh, how gorgeous!
And open that up. Mm. That's Jeff. Got. That's Jeff's mum and dad.
Mm-hmm.
This is my mum and dad. That's Jeff and I getting married.
52 years.
That's one of me when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And me and my brother and sister. Look how old-fashioned it looks at Christmas, doesn't it? Mm-hmm.
So we've been here since how long now?
2013.
So. Yeah. And we've just moved house again. So we just had our grandson stay the last week, and we had to take him back up to get the flight from Canberra back to Brisbane. And we took him to Parliament House, Old Parliament House and new, but we were in the Old Parliament House. There was a letter. There was a board of different, what people think of Australia. And there was one there that said, "Thank you, Australia. Thank you for letting me come and live here." And it was just, actually, I think we've got it on the phone. I'll have to read it. But it was just, it was everything I thought, this letter, and it was up on the board, and that was only a few days ago. So it was quite good. Mm. Because when we've gone back to England, it hasn't felt like home. when we've come back to Australia, it's almost like the Pope, we could kiss the ground because we're back in Australia. Yeah. Mm. We've really settled here. Mm. And our family have done good things too because of our decision. You know, they've got good jobs. Yeah, they've got good lives. And the grandkids. It was very free. And I got a job, as I said, at the cathedral. And my boss, I'd been used to working in the bank. And everything was very just so, you know, you had the manager here and the chief clerk here and the da-da-da. And it was very, yes. I went to work there and it was so, oh, you know, my boss, you know, said, call me Dan. I said, I can't call you Dan. I've got to call you Mr. Flynn. I can't call you Dan. You're my boss. He said, oh, no, but that's the way we do it. But by the same token, when I went there, I was told I couldn't wear trousers to work and I had to wear stockings. And here it is, you know, 30-odd degrees, and I'm thinking, you've got to wear stockings? You know, you couldn't wear sandals and bare legs or something? Yeah, so I thought that was a bit, you know, old-fashioned, interesting, you know, the contradiction.
Total.
Of the two things, you know, call me Dan, but wear stockings. I thought, oh, that's weird. Yeah. You would have heard about the bushfires down here a couple of years ago. Well, I was president of the Rotary Club, and it was a wonderful year. We were doing so well. We were various things happening until November. So from July to November, we had a fabulous time. Then we had the bushfires started in the national park just over the way here. And we were living at the other side of the river then. And our house was threatened, even though we were in the suburbs, really. But as you all know, what happened with the bushfires, the shocking, shocking time everyone had. And the club went through it too. We had two gentlemen in the club who lost everything. They lost the house, the contents, everything. Both of them had lost their wives only 18 months previous. So that not only had they lost the house, they'd lost all the memories. And just shortly after that, we had all the media. We had the Australia Day, which Jeff had been in charge of. And because we started planning in September for Australia Day, we had it all in place. And we were the only function on Australia Day. The funny one was we had the Today Show, and they asked us if we'd do a barbecue, which Rotary are always renowned for the barbecues, just underneath the Rotary clock in town, and which we did. So it was Carl Stefanovic and
Ali.
Yes. So he came over and started talking, and I'm telling him about, you know, that what the town had gone through and how we'd tried to hug the community with an Australia Day breakfast and all the rest. And he had his arm around me and he said, are you touching my bottom? Are you feeling my bottom or something? What did he say? And so I just played along. I said, yes, it's a lovely little bottom, isn't it? And all this. And so it went, and I said, this actually went out on TV. And since then, I've had so many people come back and said, I saw you on TV. You were so funny. It wasn't funny at the time, was it?
But they wanted to confirm, did he actually touch his bottom?
No, I didn't actually, but you know. But it's taken the town a long time to get over the bushfires. And I know we helped in a big way. We opened, we had the hub in Mogo. Mogo is, what, 5 km from Batemans Bay. And there's a lot of indigenous families and small acreage properties around. And the fire went through all that. And we had Rotarians come down from Sydney helping us, and we were actually on the ground going round, you know, just checking that people were okay and what they'd lost and what they needed, because we had a team of of handymen that could come and put fences back up and all the rest. So, but the main thing was the actual psychological. It was just terrible. Yeah, it was we wouldn't want to go through it again. But I would say our relatives and friends are quite envious of the fact that we came to Australia and that they didn't take the plunge. A few of them have said that to us. Yes. We thought about it, but we didn't dare do it. Perhaps we were a little bit naive and just jumped in, but yes, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.